This is the story of, well, two planes. An Egyptair 737-800 that was on its way from Cairo to Copenhagen, and a Cessna 172 that was flying from Ronne in Denmark to Copenhagen Roskilde on the Danish island of Zealand. By the way, to all of my Swedish and Danish followers, I am so sorry for butchering the names of your cities. Apologies in advance. At 12:32 p.m. UTC, on the 28th of July 2014, a Cessna was maintaining 4,000 feet as it got in touch with Swedish control. The controller in Sweden asked the pilot of the Cessna to squawk 7232. A squawk code allows ATC and airplanes to communicate more effectively. Each plane will be given a squawk code before takeoff. It allows ATC to see data such as airspeed and heading on their displays. During the squawk code change, the pilot of the Cessna made a mistake. The pilot entered 7032 instead of 7232. The controller at first did not notice this, but the controller was being replaced by another controller. The mistake was noticed and the pilot of the Cessna was asked to correct the squawk code. As the new air traffic controller started their shift, the Cessna approached the terminal control area of Malmo, Sweden. The pilot of the Cessna stayed on the heading that he was on. He believed that he had permission to cross the controlled area at 4,000 feet, but unknown to him, an Egyptair 737 was rocketing over the southern coast of Sweden, heading right towards him. Flight 759 was at 8,200 feet and descending. Copenhagen Approach identified the Egyptian 737 on their scopes, and they let the pilot of the 737 know about their positive ID. As this happened, the Cessna entered the Copenhagen terminal area from the Malmo terminal area. This is when things got a bit messy for the pilot of the Cessna, like literally. The passenger in the Cessna threw up all over the cockpit. Well, the pilot of the Cessna wasn't having a good day. The passenger had thrown up all over his tablet and the cockpit. He was focused on the sick passenger and cleaning up the cockpit as the plane wandered deeper and deeper into the terminal control area of Copenhagen. As all of this unfolded, the 737 had descended down to 4,000 feet. At this point, both planes were on a collision course and they were closing in on each other at hundreds of knots. In the cockpit of the 737, the pilots noticed something off to their 2 o'clock, something almost stationary. As the planes got closer, the pilots of the 737 realized in horror that it was another plane. On the ground, the radar screen showed the two blobs converging on each other. The distance between them dropped as the planes got closer and closer. Within seconds, the radar screen read that the distance between them was 0.0 nautical miles. Radar could no longer tell one plane apart from the other. The planes merged over the outskirts of Holviken in Sweden. The pilot of the Cessna instantly threw the plane into a right-hand turn in order to avoid the 737 that had seemingly come out of nowhere. The pilots of the 737 radioed ATC that they had just seen a Cessna pass in front of them at close range. A flight information service officer got in contact with the pilot of the Cessna and demanded that he descend as soon as possible. The pilot of the Cessna obliged. The rest of the flight went by without a hitch and both planes landed safely. On the ground, when the investigators went over the radar tracks for the flight, they saw that the Cessna's radar track was missing a lot of crucial information, like its altitude, for example. The transponder of the Cessna was supposed to broadcast a whole host of information about the plane, including altitude, but for some reason, it didn't. It wasn't enough to just turn on the transponder. You had to turn it on, set the correct squawk code, and then you had to set it into the alt mode. If you just turned it on, it would only broadcast the squawk code. Only in the alt mode would it broadcast additional information, like altitude. When they tested the equipment, they found no faults with it. In fact, the transponder had no issues after the serious encounter that it had with the 737. To find out why the transponder didn't work, they interviewed the pilot of the Cessna. He said that the transponder had worked fine on previous flights, and that he had set the transponder to the alt mode before the accident flight, but for whatever reason, it didn't work. Why do you think the transponder malfunctioned? Let me know in the comments below. But this tiny failure had massive consequences. Without the transponder, ATC was in the dark about the plane's altitude. It just showed up on their screens as a blob with no real metadata. This failure set up the whole accident. As all of this happened, in the cockpit of the 737, the TCAS had activated. TCAS, or Traffic Collision and Avoidance System, is a safety feature that constantly scans all aircraft in a particular range and then calculates the answer to the question, is this plane going to be near me in the foreseeable future? If the system thinks that a plane might get too close for comfort, then it'll warn its pilots about the potential conflict. In this case, that worked perfectly. The pilots of the 737 were warned 40 seconds before the merge, and they were able to take evasive action. But the investigation circled back to the Cessna after they exonerated the pilots of the 737. They couldn't figure out why the transponder didn't transmit the necessary details, only that it didn't. As mentioned before, that set up the mistakes that were about to follow. You see, when you enter a terminal control area, you're required to announce your presence and your altitude when you enter and when you leave. It's kind of like aviation's, I'm here, no one bump into me. The pilot took the initial contact that he had with Swedish controllers as permission to enter Swedish terminal control area. When he entered the Malmo TCA, his position report was incomplete. He did not mention his altitude. This could be explained by the fact that he was a relatively inexperienced pilot. He only had about 52 hours in the cockpit. So now, the pilot thinks that he's cleared to pass through the controlled airspace at 4,000 feet. ATC thinks that the Cessna is well below 4,000 feet, as that's where most general aviation airplanes flew. The shift change at the Swedish control center did nothing to improve the situational awareness. The new Swedish controller didn't have a readout of the plane's altitude because of the malfunctioning transponder. Also, the pilot did not make the callouts that he was supposed to, and since most general aviation planes flew much lower, the new controller just assumed that the Cessna was at a lower altitude and posed no threat to other traffic. For pretty much the same reasons, the Danish controller at Copenhagen failed to realize that the Cessna was not where it should have been. When all this happened, the passenger in the Cessna threw up, adding to the workload of the already inexperienced pilot. The confusion in the cockpit kept the pilot from noticing the 737 that was starting to creep up on him. So, the small Cessna slipped through the cracks and stayed at 4,000 feet, where it was at risk of flying into a jet. Going over the radar data for the near miss showed how close the planes actually came. The pilots of the 737 reported that the Cessna was about 2 nautical miles away. The radar system showed that the separation between both planes was 0.0 nautical miles. That meant that the planes had less than 0.05 nautical miles of space separating them. If the distance between them was greater, then the radar system would have shown that they were 0.1 nautical miles apart. 0.05 nautical miles, that's 92 meters or 101 yards. You can run that distance in a few seconds. A jet would cover that distance in the blink of an eye. That's how close these two planes were. In the end, what changed? Well, after this, the Swedish and Danish control systems now use the letter N to denote planes that are not broadcasting altitude data. They also set out to start an educational program to inform pilots about the rules of visual flying. They also set up a ground-based radar tool that would warn controllers if an unauthorized aircraft penetrated a certain airspace. They also suggested that pilots follow a few general rules during all phases of flight. In the end, this could have been way worse than it was. In this case, the pilot of the Cessna probably had to make a very awkward phone call after this, and the pilots of the 737 got an experience that they'll never forget. Much better than the alternative, if you ask me. What do you think of all of this? Let me know in the comments below. If you want to watch more from my channel, might I suggest this video of a giant C-17 landing on a tiny runway in Afghanistan? Enjoy. Thank you for watching this episode of Mini Air Crash Investigation. If you like the videos that I make, do consider liking and subscribing. It will really help the channel grow. I will catch you guys next time. Stay safe.